Hello, Aspergers. Today I climbed a beautiful hill in Rome and I shot some video for you, and then I realized that my camera was working, but my microphone wasn't working, so it was all for naught. And then I had a massive meltdown and killed everyone on Janicolo Hill! No, not really. I stayed very calm, actually. Even right now, I'm supposed to be Skyping with one of you, and she's having technical difficulties. Am I melting down? No, I'm using my time wisely. I'm fixing my straps. So I want to talk about sensory issues, because I don't need to wear this right now, because I was on a beach yesterday with a friend, and she asked me what sensory issues I have. And I thought about it for a few seconds, and I said, holy crap, I don't really have many. I don't really have more than a neurotypical. Yeah, so how did this fantastic change come about? Well, let me take a sip of my wine, and I shall tell you, I mean tea, it is tea. I'm like this normally. When I drink wine, I become very, very ordinary. And I say things like, I think you should have insurance. Okay, so when I first started, like 6 years ago or whenever it was, I had a lot of sensory issues. And it was very mind-blowing for me. It was very revelatory. I was able to list my issues. I was able to manage my issues once I listed them. Let's get a little more comfortable, shall we? There's my bed back there. We're not going to get that comfortable. I was able to list them, and I was able to find counter-stimulants to help me to deal with them. I then created for myself sort of a little sensory backpack, you know, which was just basically whatever bag I was carrying, I would put supplies in it, you know, sensory supplies like earplugs, gloves, hats, glasses, scarves, you know, water, and something to eat if my blood sugar dropped, which makes, of course, we know is very dangerous for us Aspies. You know, fidget toys, soft things, all that kind of stuff. And then, like a lot of you, I arranged my life so that it was very tranquil. You know, knowing about your sensory issues is important, especially in the beginning, because then you can have your counter-stimulants and you can avoid things that you know will make you melt down. You can choose vacations, you can choose activities, you can choose even where you're going to live, you know, at least partially based on sensory issues, at least with awareness. I think it's important to have awareness. And then, of course, like many of you, I orchestrated my life so that I became very, very comfortable. Everything was very quiet and peaceful and tranquil. You know, it was like living in Howard's End, except, of course, without the dead person. Well, actually, you know, there might be a few dead people lying around, but we won't talk about that now. Anyway, I ended up in a very rural, tranquil environment, and I felt like I was in a silk-lined coffin. I mean, everything was perfect, and everything was boring. So then I was thrust into the world and had to, in a way, start all over again. Now, what happened with me in the last 6 months, as some of you know, I went to Athens, and I don't know, went through some mystical experience or something, I don't know. But all of a sudden, everything that used to really bother me doesn't bother me anymore. It's like it has become part of the fabric of the material of my life. When I went to shoot this video today, I live in a quiet neighborhood, and I took my laptop and my audio box and my microphone with very heavy mic stand, and I trudged the neighborhood, and I went up Janicolo Hill, which is a very tall hill. And I went to the La Fontana Acqua Paola, Fontana dell'Acqua Paola, my favorite fountain in Rome, with a beautiful view of the city. And all of a sudden, I became conscious of all the noises, the noise of the fountain, the noise of the wind, the noise of the tourists and the cars driving by. And that became very significant. I also popped into a hotel, a very tranquil hotel. It used to be an old monastery, and there was some music playing on speakers, which I hadn't noticed in there before, and all of a sudden it became significant. Then I walked through some woods, and the wood sound of the woods, there was either, I don't like tree frogs or some kind of crickets making this huge, you know, cricketing noise, and it it sounded massive. And then I went up on Janiglo Hill, and there was wind and all kinds of things, tourists. And I thought, my God, there's noises everywhere. But my point is, I would not have noticed them if I hadn't been looking for them. And so what I think has happened with me over the last few months is that all the sounds which had been sort of external to myself and which made me angry, which made me upset, now have become sort of comforting to me, have become part of the music of my internal life, not just my external life, but my internal life. We think about the body, there's heartbeats, there's body fluids, there's all kinds of things going on inside the body. All you need is a stethoscope to hear it. And I think, you know, it's like Aspies that love heavy metal or love to ride motorbikes. Those are noisy things, but we love them. But if somebody makes a noise that loud that we don't like or that's not in our control, it becomes extremely offensive to us. So I think there's, you know, there's the control issue. We must understand that you cannot control the world. You absolutely cannot control the world. And the harder you will grip and the harder you will try, the more difficult your life will be, because you will offend and you will annoy and you will isolate yourself. I've seen it firsthand. I've seen it firsthand with myself, and I've seen it firsthand with other Aspies, both diagnosed and undiagnosed. The second thing that you can do is to, you know, redirect your attention. So if something is bothering you, Jim Carrey, when he had his makeup done for The Grinch, had to undergo 8 hours of torturous prosthetic makeup every day for 100 days. That's 800 hours of torture. And they brought in a CIA operative trainer to teach him how to deal with torture, how to direct his mind and body elsewhere. So if something's bothering you, find something else that's really riveting to focus on, even if it's a thought in your own head, a positive thought, a good thought, a groovy thought. So redirection, reframing the noise. I was on my balcony yesterday and they were starting to have a block party, and I was PO'd. I was pissed off because I wasn't invited, of course, because, you know, I'm the lady in red on the balcony. But also, I was PO'd because it was really, really noisy. And it was hot, and I wanted to sit outside, and then all of a sudden I stopped, and I thought, you know, what if there was some kind of disastrous thing, you know, a war or something, and everybody was killed, and everybody was gone, and I was the only person left in the city. Just think of how grateful you would be to hear the sound of human beings at that point. The sound of children playing and old people laughing and, you know, and adolescents flirting and all that stuff that you might find annoying at some time. So I reframed it. That's a pretty dramatic reframing, but that's how my mind works. I go where I need to go to be happy. And if I have to think of a huge disaster like a nuclear world war to do it, by George, I will. Something very wrong with me. What else? So we've got let's recap. So we list our sensory triggers, we come up with our counter stimulants, our antidotes, we have our sensory backpack, we have a list by the door, we go nowhere without our things, we become happier, we orchestrate our life to where we're comfortable, and then we start to enjoy the music of life. We start to bring these things into our body and use them the way a dancer uses loud music, the way a motorcyclist, you know, rides his motorcycle, the way a painter paints out his frustration, or, you know, a composer uses horrible sounds to create music. Use the things that you see, hear, touch, smell, feel. Use them. And then we've got redirection, so putting your attention on something else. And then you've also got reframing. So that was my last example about being happy, you know, to hear something that or to feel or to experience something. So just to wrap this up, that's my Skype appointment. When you Skype with me, girls, please do test your video and audio equipment beforehand. Otherwise, I am forced to make these ridiculous videos whilst I wait for you all. What else do I want to say about sensory issues? Become healthy. If you eat ho-hos and Twinkies all day and never exercise, your body inside is going to be like, you're not going to have any strength, any physical stamina, any strength. I was doing an awful lot of gluten in the last few months. I know the gluten controversy, but I don't care. I decided to go off of it again. So I started my day with, you know, juice and gluten-free pasta with vegetables and healthy things, you know, and good stiff walk up a mountain, you know. We must take care of our bodies. These are our machines, ladies. These are our canvases. These are our tools. This is what you've got, honey. Take care of it. What else did I want to say about sensory issues? Tips. You know, Babs. I love you, Babs. She mentioned today on Facebook, scratchy sheets. Ooh, horrid, horrid things. Let me show you what I have. This is a silk scarf. Go to a fabric store, get a giant swath of silk for 10 quid and cut it and then travel with it. It folds up into the size of an amoeba. It's positively minuscule. You could stuff this almost in your bra. You know, it can go anywhere with you. And then you've got instant silk sheets. If you have sensory questions, if you would like more handy-dandy tips on how to keep yourself comfortable while traveling through Rome, just ask Aunt Aspie. Ask, dare I say, Rudy, I have changed my name to Artemisia. I don't know why. I'm me. I'm an Aspie. What do you want? What do you want from me, eh? What do you want? Normal? I can't do it. Okay. Bye for now. Love you. Ciao.